Hello friends, good afternoon and welcome to EduSat Live Lectures. Dear friends, today in zoology we will be discussing about history of immunology. To discuss this topic, we have with us our subject expert, Dr. Hardeep Kaur. Dr. Kaur is Assistant Professor in Department of Zoology in Ramjas College, University of Delhi. Without further ado, I would like to welcome ma'am to our studios and request her to start the lecture. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Amrit. So friends, today we'll be dealing with the history of immunology. As they say, to understand any subject, the history of that subject is to know about it is very, very important. I have discussed this lecture in two parts, part 1 and part 2. The part 1 covers the entire history of immunology up to the era of Pasteur. Post-Pasteur discoveries and its related things I have discussed in part 2, which will be followed by part 1. So to begin with, in the history of immunology, we can say that immunology stems from a Latin word immunis, which means exempt. The word immunity has been derived from this Latin word immunis, which means protection from the disease. Initially, it was thought that whenever a person has contracted a disease, he will become protected from that particular disease and he will not contract the disease again, and he would be able to take care of the diseased person in future. The term immunity was first used in 1775 by Van Swieten, a Dutch physician, as immunitas to describe the effects induced by an early attempt at virilization, which means inoculation against smallpox using material from a smallpox lesion. Now, coming back to the actual history of immunology, the history of immunology dates back to BC, maybe 2000 BC ago. So, as early as 2000 BC, disease and epidemics were rampant in Egypt. Too many people were dying. It was considered a punishment by God. People who used to get affected by a disease, they were considered to be having a bad soul, bad spirit, bad thoughts. It was considered that a person who's being who's not believing in God will be afflicted by a disease. Such a person must rectify himself. He must come back to his senses. He should start believing in God, or he would be perished. He would suffer a disease, and he would eventually perish. So, under these circumstances, the main aspects of immunology were lost. People hardly believed in anything besides God. They were only considered that if you believe God, they will be protected. If they do not believe God, they are sinful, they will be afflicted by a disease, they will have an eventual death. So, according to Thucydides, the great historian of the Peloponnesian War, this is actually the first documented proof which states that in 430 BC, a plague whose pathogen was unknown at that time afflicted Athens. And only those individuals who survived plague, they were expected to take care of the diseased people, and they did not experience the plague again. This was the first documented proof that immunity existed, and this showed that people were aware. But then maybe 2000 years elapsed, many decades went off, but nothing much happened later. Later, a term variolation came up. This means the obsolete process of inoculating a susceptible person with material taken from a vesicle of a person who has smallpox. Now, from where did this origin of inoculation against smallpox came up? Initially, it was thought that perhaps it is the Chinese and the Turks way back in 10th century BC, or they were actually 10 BC, then AD, which who were doing all these works on immunology, the work of variolation, they were working on them. The origin of inoculation against smallpox was thought to exist in China. The technique originated at the southern province of Sichuan. References have been made to a temple, Omin Shan, which is followed by Buddhist and Taoist alchemists in the 10th century. The Taoist alchemists there lived as hermits in the caves of that mountain. This technique, they used to practice lot many things over there. It was not known what exactly they used to do there. The first, this technique, when did it came into public attention was when the eldest son of the Prime Minister Wong Tan died of smallpox. Wong Tan was so depressed that in order to take care of his other people in his family, he invited magicians, physicians from all over his kingdom, and he requested them to devise something to save all other members of his family. Many people came, magicians came, sorcerers came, so many people came. So during that time, Taoist hermit came from Ominshan. Ominshan is the temple I just described. He's described as a holy physician or a luminous old woman. In that case, it would be a nun, a Oja board immortal who came and actually did the practice of variolation. So this shows that variolation did have its root probably in the 10th century and extended up to maybe 15th century. Later in his book, Dozen Zinfa, published in 1549, Chinese author Wan Quan made clear reference to the process of variolation. Inoculation for smallpox does not appear to be widespread in China until the reign era of Longqin Emperor during the Ming Dynasty. Description of this variolation practice are recorded by Yu Chang in his book Miscellaneous Ideas in Medicine of 1643. As you can see from the pictorial depiction, here it shows, the first three picture actually shows a man having smallpox pustules. A needle has been inserted in the pustule and the living matter or material has been extracted from this pustule and is used for variolating other individuals. So this shows, this is actually an excerpt from the book of Yu Yang. Later, during the 17th century, the practice from China was slowly introduced into neighboring countries along the Silk Road. And it was in Turkey that it came to the attentions of Europeans. English merchant John Lister reported the Chinese method to the Royal Society in 1700. While talking about India, in pre-colonial India, tikka or dot would be made on the sole of the foot by tikadars. As you can see in the picture, that's an Indian variolation vial containing live smallpox virus. It's one of the rarest pictures which can be found in the history. Now, coming back to variolation, specifically in Europe, European variolation was performed by a puncture in the skin. And we cannot forget the contribution of Lady Mary Wortley Montague. Lady Mary Wortley Montague was the wife of British ambassador to Constantinople. She was a wonderful lady who was a poetess herself and was herself a victim of smallpox. She had lost her eyelashes and had to be, and her face was badly marked by the smallpox, the scars of smallpox. She had to constantly wear a veil to save her from the public scrutiny. Now, Lady Mary Wortley Montague first discovered inoculation for smallpox while she was in Constantinople between 1716 to 1718. She first of all inoculated the smallpox pustule material in her son, followed by inoculating her daughter in 1721 when she returned back to Europe. When she returned back to Europe, England, she advocated this practice a lot over there. But as expected, people were very against it. She was given a very bad, she was bad mouthed, and so many people were against her practice of variolation. Six prisoners who were sentenced to execution and six orphaned children were variolated to test the theory, and they survived after being variolated. After this test, later, this practice was adopted by the royal family. In fact, Prince and Princess of Wales were given variolation in the later part of 18th century. After once it was introduced into the royal family, the practice spread throughout Europe. This is a wordings from Lady Mary Wortley Montague. As she says, the smallpox so fatal and so general amongst us is here entirely harmless by the invention of engrafting. Engrafting is nothing but variolation only, which is the term they gave it. There is a set of old women who make it their business to perform the operation every autumn in the month of September when the great heat is abated. People send to one another to know if any of their family has a mind to have the smallpox, and they make special parties for this purpose. These are the words of Lady Mary Wortley Montague. Now, by the second half of 18th century, Europe was being ravaged by a smallpox epidemic. It affected societies dramatically. Prince William died at the age of 11. Mozart, George Washington, and Abraham Lincoln were all affected. Beauty decorations such as veils were believed to hide the scars, and they became very popular at that time. By this time in rural England, it was noticed that women who milked cows were frequently spared clinical smallpox disease. Edward Jenner was born in May 17, 1749 in Berkeley, Gloucestershire in England. He was a small teenager who was learning to practice medicine. While learning it through a physician, he heard a young farm girl telling the doctor that she could not contract smallpox because she had once had cowpox. This is a case of serendipity and with an acute sense of learning from that. You know, this started him to think more about a vaccine. Maybe people like us would not have noticed it, but Edward Jenner noticed this concept. He followed this concept wherein he found that yes, people who got afflicted with cowpox later did not develop smallpox. So later in 1796, Sarah Nelms, one of his milkmaid, contracted cowpox and she went to Jenner for treatment. Jenner took this opportunity to test his theory. He inoculated James Phipps. In some books it's also mentioned as Edward Phipps, maybe it's James Edward Phipps. That's the 8-year-old son of his gardener. He took the material from the cowpox lesions on the Sarah's hand. The hand shown in the figure is actually Sarah's hand. This is coming from the actually excerpt of Jenner's books. After a mild fever and the expected local lesion, James recovered after a few days. After about 2 months, Jenner was inoculated on both the arms with material from a case of smallpox, that is a virulent vaccinia, virulent virus. With no effect, the boy was immune to smallpox. Now, in fact, it is documented that to show his gratitude, actually, Jenner provided, Jenner gave a house to Phipps just across the lane where he used to live. That house is still there, if in Berkeley. That house can still be seen where Phipps later lived. That was the house provided by Jenner to Phipps as a mark of gratitude. Jenner wrote a paper in 1798 explaining his experiments and wanted to report his first case study in the Transaction of the Royal Society of London. His study was, however, rejected. He then went to London to demonstrate his theory. No one would submit to his vaccination theory. He was discouraged. He came back to Berkeley. In 1801, Jenner published The Origin of Vaccine Inoculation, describing how cowpox virus was prepared and used to protect healthy persons against smallpox. Now, the Franco-Prussian War, which began in 1870 and lasted till 1879, here a smallpox epidemic came up in the soldiers. It was found that the French army, which was not variolated with the cowpox vaccine, there about 23,400 soldiers died. However, the German army, which was vaccinated, only 278 died, hence showing the efficacy of vaccination. Some people believe that Lord Jeffrey Amherst, Commander-in-Chief for America, may have used smallpox blankets against the Indians during the French-India War in 1754 to 1763. This can be first called a documented proof of biological warfare, maybe. Now, was Jenner the first one to come up with the theory of vaccination? Maybe not, because 20 years before Jenner actually came up with the theory of vaccination, a person named Benjamin Jesty came up with this entire technique. Edward Jenner, we popularly called him the father of smallpox vaccination. Of course, he dedicated his entire life, money and reputation in spreading the use of cowpox vaccine. But in 1774, 2 decades before Jenner's experiment on James Phipp, a farmer called Benjamin Jesty vaccinated his wife. What happened actually, there was a outbreak of cowpox in his farm. So Jesty, what he did, he took his wife and children. He was living at Jetminster in Dorset. He took his wife and children to the local cow farm where he subjected them to this cowpox vaccine, the cowpox variolation technique using a needle. Now, unfortunately, his wife developed fever. Now, because of development of fever, of course, his wife survived and she lived for a long time. But that time, people started, he became a subject of mockery for the people around. He was hooted at, reviled and pelted whenever he attended markets in the neighborhood. This has been written in the history that he was hooted at, reviled and pelted whenever he attended markets in the neighborhood. So much so, the family has to move to Isle of Purbeck. Now, there a gravestone actually tells this entire story, how Jesty was subjected to so much of mockery of the neighborhood and how eventually this was the first proof which states that probably vaccination was there before Jenner actually invented it. Jesty is the live proof of it, 2 decades before Jenner actually came up with variolation or vaccination. Now, what does vaccination actually means? Vaccually is a Latin word which comes from a word called vexa, which means cow. So, in 19th century, the French scientist Louis Pasteur experimented with antigens to combat anthrax and rabies and called these antigens as vaccines in Jenner's honor. In those days, people used to give a lot of honor to each other. So, that time, since Jenner was the first one, he was the pioneer who came up with this idea of vaccination. And since he worked on cowpox, so vaccination, this term vaccination, who Louis Pasteur gave, was in reverence or in honor of Jenner. Pasteur also extensively worked on fowl cholera. Nowadays, we use the word vaccination to describe a procedure in which a patient is inoculated with an antigen. This antigen is generally an attenuated or a weakened antigen to produce an immunity against a particular disease. Now, coming back to this, the Koch Pasteur and the germ theory. In 1875, Robert Koch, who was a country physician with no formal scientific training, inoculated the ear of a rabbit with the blood of an animal that had died of anthrax, and rightly so, the rabbit died the next day. He isolated the infected lymph nodes from the rabbit and was able to show that the bacteria contained within them, within the lymph nodes, can easily transfer disease to other animals. He hence discovered the tubercle bacillus and tuberculin. The detailed bacillus skin test, the detailed tuberculin skin test, which is also called DTH test, and hence he was awarded the Nobel Prize in 1905. Now, coming back to Louis Pasteur, Louis Pasteur began his studies of the chicken cholera bacillus. What did he do? He actually was able to find the bacillus which is causing cholera in fowl. So, he had that bacillus in his laboratory. For a long vacation. So, when he came back, the bacteria was still there, but it was an old aged bacteria. Now, he had a limited supply of fowl. He got a new supply of fowl. He used that same bacillus, which was an old bacillus, into this fowl, these number of fowls. Now, all these fowls did develop the disease, but they never died, unlike what used to happen before. Before, he used to inoculate and all fowl used to die. But this time, when he used this old bacteria or bacillus into the fowl became ill but survived. Now, he recultured or subcultured this bacillus, grew a better strain, better agile strain, and now inoculated the same fowl. His supply of fowl was limited, unfortunately, or fortunately for us now. His supply of fowl was limited, so he inoculated the same fowl with this virulent or maybe fresh fresh lot of bacteria. Now, all these fowl did not even develop the disease. So, he thought about it and he came up to the concept of aged or attenuated bacteria, and he hypothesized that aging probably weakened the pathogen, and this weakened pathogen can be used as a vaccine to prevent the disease. Pasteur later worked on anthrax and rabies and developed the first viable vaccine for anthrax and rabies. He later also developed pasteurization, a process by which harmful microbes in perishable food products are destroyed by heat without destroying the food. On July 4, 1886, 9-year-old Joseph Mister was bitten repeatedly by a rabid dog, a dog who's been afflicted with rabies. Pasteur treated him with his attenuated rabies vaccine 2 days later. Mister survived. Joseph Mister later became a gatekeeper for the Pasteur Institute. In 1940, it is known that when he was ordered by the German occupiers to open Pasteur crypt, Joseph refused and later committed suicide. He was so thoroughly true to Pasteur. It is also known that although Koch and Pasteur's were contemporaries, they were intensely competitive and actually bitter enemies. So, in one of the scientific meets, after Pasteur has delivered his lecture and Koch was to occupy the podium, he said, this is actually his quote, "When I saw in the program that Monsieur Pasteur was to speak today, I attended the meeting eagerly, hoping to learn something new. I must confess that I have been disappointed, as there is nothing new in the speech which Monsieur Pasteur has just made." This may be called the worst thing which any scientist would have said about another scientist. Although many consider Pasteur the father of immunology, it is due to both his and Koch's efforts that firmly established the germ theory of disease. Before this, people had done variolation, people had done vaccination, but they were not aware about the concept, the real causative agent, why it is happening. It is due to Koch work and Pasteur and Koch work later that they discovered the biological aspect, that what goes into a process of vaccination. Hence, the theory was called the germ theory of Pasteur and Koch. So, finally, I would end this part by saying that if you don't know history, then you don't know anything. You know that you are a leaf, but you do not know that you are actually a part of the tree. So, to know more about any aspect of sciences, one must know the history of that science. This was our first attempt, part 1, to understand the history of immunology. This will be followed by part 2 on the history of immunology. Thank you very much. We'll be right back. Welcome back, students. This is part 2 on the history of immunology, wherein we are dealing about all the discoveries and inventions made in immunology post-Pasteur era. So, coming back to it, in the last part 1, let us go back and recall what we had done in the previous lecture. In the previous lecture, we learned the following important aspects of history of immunology. We learned that in 430 BC, an outbreak of plague happened. It is the first documented proof that showed people were aware about immunity. It was found that people who survived this outbreak of plague, they were able to take care of those individuals who were still afflicted by plague. This is actually, since it's the first documented proof, it becomes very important for us. Anything which is documented can only be read, you see. People might be following immunology since ages, but we do not know about it because it's not been documented in the history. So this was the first documented proof. Then came the technique of variolation, which was being performed by Chinese and Turk, Buddhist and Taoist alchemists. And you remember that this was, I told you about a specific temple where this these alchemists used to stay there. And they used to perform this practice of variolation. This happened in around 10th to 15th century maybe. Then the variolation which was adopted by Lady Mary Wortley Montagu in 1717. As I told you, she was the wife of British ambassador to Constantinople. And she actually, she saw all this variolation going on over there in Constantinople. And she actually applied this technique of variolation in her own children. Later, this technique was adapted and people, many, initially some orphan children and people who were due to be executed were variolated and they survived, at least the disease. So, later this technique was adapted by the royal family and then it became rampant, it became popular among the masses also. The work of Edward Jenner in late 18th century could never be forgotten. He was the first one who actually found out that cowpox, the material from the cowpox pustule can be actually utilized and can be used as a vaccine to treat smallpox. If you take a variolation from the cowpox pustule, you will never be able to, you may not contract smallpox. This was a pioneering work by Edward Jenner in late 18th century. In 19th century, Louis Pasteur experiments with antigens to combat anthrax and rabies. Of course, he started his work first on cholera, which was in fowl, I mean fowl cholera. Later, he worked on sheep and he also worked, he actually did a pioneering work on anthrax, wherein he used two lots of sheep. One, he tried these sheep with an attenuated strain of anthrax and the other, he did not do vaccination. And when subjected to the virulent strain of anthrax, the sheep lot which was previously exposed to the attenuated strain survived while the other did not. This was a very pioneering work. Koch-Pasteur theory of germ theory which is popularly called in 1875 further laid emphasis and told about the biological significance of vaccination of variolation. Till that time it was a technique, people didn't know what is going into it, what is the biological aspect of it. Post this era, a lot many discoveries are taking place, still taking place. So technically the field of immunology actually became very popular in the last 100 years. maximum discoveries has taken place. Although we can say that probably immunology started in the BC, maybe 430 BC, many years back, 2000 years back. But right now, it is in its prime. The last 100 years for immunology is really great. Now, later in 19th century, as you can see, Emil Adolf von Behring, he was a student of Koch. He with Kita Sato and Wanike discovered antitoxin for diphtheria and tetanus, and he applied this as a therapy. He was awarded the first Nobel Prize in Physiology in 1901. Von Behring, along with Shibasaburo Kita Sato, in 1890, this demonstrated that serum is the liquid non-cellular component of the coagulated blood. If you take a blood in the tube and let it coagulate, you will find it will form a clump or a clot, and there would be a yellowish non-cellular part of the blood which comes down. That liquid portion is called the serum. This serum from animals previously immunized to diphtheria, if the serum was utilized, it can be used to transfer the immune state to the unimmunized animals. This was a very important discovery which showed that probably it's the serum or the liquid portion of the blood which is important for transferring immunity from one individual to another. So probably the immunity lies in the liquid portion of the blood, maybe not in the cellular portion of the blood. This was the first example which gives emphasis to the fluids, the liquid portion of the blood. Hence, this laid emphasis to humoral immunity. In those days, the body fluids were called humor. So, hence this laid a new technique or rather a new nomenclature came up which was called the humoral immunity. Now, followed by this, during 1930s, mainly through the efforts of Elvin Kabat, he came up with a fraction of serum which was called gamma globulin fraction. Elvin Kabat, what he did, he subjected the serum to ultra high centrifugation. He separated the three fractions, alpha, beta, gamma globulin fractions, and he checked each fraction separately to find out what fraction is responsible for giving, providing an immunity in an individual. And he found out that it is the gamma globulin fracture, which we call it as immunoglobulins present in this fraction, which is responsible for providing immunity. Ali Metkinikov, he is an embryologist who was studying starfish development. While studying the starfish development, what he did, he subjected the starfish larvae to a dye. Now, this dye, when it went into the digestive system of the starfish larvae, he found out that certain cells, they eat up this dye and immediately devour it. He named these cells as phagocytes. Phagos means I eat. So, he found the process of phagocytosis. This is actually the birth of cellular immunity. This is the first example which shows that perhaps it is not only the body fluids which are important for immunity, but also the cells present in the blood which have an equal responsibility for producing immunity in an individual. Hence, a new term of cellular immunity or cell-mediated immunity came up. Metkinikov became a leading proponent of the cellularists, who believed that phagocytes rather than antibodies played a leading role in immunity. Now, because of this, a debate started. Some people believed in cell-mediated immunity, other people believed in humoral immunity. Now, the drawback was that people who believed in cell-mediated immunity or cellular immunity was that the process of culturing cell or growing a cell culture was very difficult in those days. So, naturally to extract the liquid portion of the blood was much easier. Hence, people dealing with humoral immunity gained more preference. But later, by the work of Merrill Chase in 1940, he succeeded in transferring immunity against tuberculosis organism by transferring white blood cells between guinea pigs. He found out that you just take white blood cells from one guinea pig who's been afflicted with tuberculosis and use these white blood cells in another individual, in another guinea pig. that guinea pig would be able to survive tuberculosis. His findings later led to the research that discovered that B cells, T cells and other types of white blood cells have a lot to do in the production of immune response in an individual. So, Merrill Chase did a tremendous work and hence promoted cell-mediated immunity. Bruce Glick at Mississippi State University indicated that there were two types of lymphocytes. The T lymphocytes, which was derived from thymus and mediated cellular immunity, and B lymphocytes, which came from bursa of Fabricius. So, now what is bursa of Fabricius? It is an outgrowth from the cloaca of birds. Now, what did they do? In 1956, actually Bruce Glick came out with a paper in which he wrote that if you remove this bursa of Fabricius in a newly hatched chick where his immunity is yet to develop fully, it severely impaired the immunity or the ability of the adult bird to produce antibodies. So, he realized that this bursa of Fabricius is perhaps important in developing antibodies in these birds. Now, later this concept was further taken up and it was found that actually the B cells which comes up or B lymphocytes in birds come up in bursa of Fabricius, while B cells are actually undergoes maturation in the bone marrow in higher organisms. So, Bruce Glick was the first one who found out that maybe the cell mediated immunity as well as the humoral immunity both are responsible for producing an immune state in an individual. Now, again the early theories of immunology. Now, as you know that whenever a new concept comes, there is always many schools of thought. So, one school of thought who described immunology gave up a theory called the selective theory. The main proponent of this person who really came up with this theory was Paul Ulrich. In 1900, Paul Ulrich proposed that cells in the blood expressed a variety of receptors, which he called the side chain receptors, that could react with infectious agents and inactivate them. Ulrich proposed that binding of the receptor to an infectious agent was like the fit between a lock and a key. Now, if you remember during this time in 1900s, the primary, secondary, tertiary and quaternary structure of proteins came up. So, during that time, the lock and key theory of enzyme action was also rampant and it was considered that the substrate binding to an enzyme was like a lock and key mechanism where every lock has a specific key and it will not be opened by any other key. Similar reference was given by Ulrich, who proposed that there are receptors on the cells present. These receptors are highly specific. So, whenever an infectious agent comes into the body, it will search for its receptor which is going to be there. It will bind to its receptor in exactly a lock and key mechanism, and further this binding would induce the cell to produce and release more of the receptors of the same specificity. That means these receptors are already present in the fluid, in the body, in the blood, and what happens once an infectious agent comes, it will come and bind to this receptor. This receptor, once tinkered, will produce more of its kind and hence will take care of this infectious agent. Now, according to Ulrich theory, the specificity of the receptor was determined before its exposure to the antigen. And the antigen selected the appropriate receptor. That means the receptor is already present. The antigen comes in, finds out which receptor it wants to bind with, what is giving it the best fit, the best fitted receptor it binds to, and this receptor is not tinkered to produce more of its kind. So, in the 1930s and 40s, this theory was very popular. But by the time 1930s, 40s, the selective theory was challenged by another theory which was called the instructional theory. Now, as I just mentioned, Paul Ulrich developed a series of tissue staining dyes including that for tubercle bacillus. He worked with Koch. He developed antitoxin diphtheria. He side chain theory of antibody formation, as just I just told you, which is the selective theory, surface, where he said that surface receptors are bound by lock and key mechanism and antigen stimulate these receptors. In 1908, he shared the Nobel Prize with Metchnikoff. In fact, the illustration which is shown here is coming from one of his early publications. This is the original illustration from his publication only. Now, followed by this, as already told you, as I just said, that in 1940s, this selection theory was basically given off, you know, new theory came up. There is another school of thoughts which said that no, it is not happening like this. They came up with another theory which was called the instructional theory. Now, as I just told you, this was the time perhaps when the protein structure came up. We all know that antibody is a protein. Now, in 1930s and 40s, instructional theories surfaced, in which antigen played a central role in determining the specificity of the antibody molecule. Now, what they said was, here the antigen is playing a key role. The antigen is describing how the antibody or the receptor should behave. In this, a particular antigen would serve as a template around which the antibody would fold. What does it mean? That antibody is a very flexible molecule. The antigen comes inside the body, it recognizes an antibody. Antibody need not have a compatible structure to the antigen. What the antigen does? Antigen gives an instruction to the antibody to mold itself around it. That means it is providing a very flexible nature to the antibody, a very flexible, a moldable, a malleable, a very flexible structure to this antibody molecule. It was giving an instruction to antibody to now change its shape according to the antigen. So, the antibody molecule therefore would thereby assume a configuration which is going to be complementary to that of the antigen template. This concept was first postulated by Frederick Brunel and Felix Horowitz about 1930 and was redefined in 1940s in terms of protein folding by Linus Pauling. The instructional theories were, however, disapproved in 1960s. This was a major setback. Initially, the selection theory came. Selection theory was disapproved in 1940s. Later, the instructional theory came. Instructional theory was later disapproved in 1960s. Now came the clonal selection theory, which we still follow. So, in 1950s, Niels Jerne, David Talmage and F. McFarlane Burnett came up with the clonal selection theory. Here in clonal selection theory, they said an individual lymphocyte expresses membrane receptors that are specific for a distinct antigen. You see, what they are trying to say that we have many cells which are having receptors. These receptors are, these cells which are we are talking about are lymphocyte, and this receptor we are talking about is actually an antibody. What they are trying to say that lymphocytes have specific receptors or antibodies which are there, and each lymphocyte has only one type of receptor or only one types of antibodies present on them. This unique receptor specificity is determined before the lymphocyte is exposed to the antigen. Before the antigen has even come inside the body, various lymphocytes with different receptors are already there. Now, binding of an antigen to its specific receptor activates that cell, causing it to proliferate into clones of cells. Now, once antigen has entered the body, it finds its own lymphocyte having its specific receptor. The receptor would have a best binding with this antigen. Once this binding has taken place, it gives a feedback to the cell to undergo clonal expansion. Clonal expansion means produce more clones of the same cell. The same cell once undergoes cloning or further proliferation or clonal expansion, as it is now said, it will produce more of its kind. More cells of the same kind will produce numerous antibodies or receptors of the same kind. So, hence one antigen enters, binds to the lymphocyte with a specific receptor of antibody, tinkers this cell to undergo clonal expansion to produce more of its kind. More antibodies against the same antigen is produced, and hence it takes care of the antigen. So, therefore, binding of antigen to its specific receptor activates the cell, causing it to proliferate into a clone of cells that have the same immunologic specificity as the parent cell. The clonal selection is now accepted as the underlying prototype of modern immunology. The key difference from the Ulrich theory was every cell was presumed to synthesize only one sort of antibody. Now, after antigen binding, the cell proliferates, hence forming a clone producing the same antibody. As you can see in the figure, this is a correct representation of clonal selection theory. As you can see, there are four different types of lymphocytes I have shown here. There is one, green, red, blue and yellow. Now, once the antigen has come, it has recognized the lymphocyte bearing the receptor which has the best fit with it, that is the red one. It led to proliferation of that particular cell. Numerous hundred thousands of same types of cells are produced, so that it is a predominance of that particular cell in the blood at this moment with this that particular receptor or antibody. Now, what these cells will eventually do? They will maybe the antibody will go into the blood, they will become plasma cells, or plasma cells are nothing but a antibody producing factory, you know, they will keep on producing antibodies. They might actually become memory cells. So, they might be becoming an effector cell or a memory cell. They can become an antibody producing factory, or they can become memory cells keeping the memory of antigen alive forever. And hence, the second time the antigen comes in, we already have preformed antibodies in our blood. That's called the primary response and the secondary response, which probably will take up later in immunology. But right now, since we are dealing with the history, we'll just confine ourselves to the history. So, coming back to it, that's Sir Frank McFarlane Burnett. He, as I just told you, he further formalized the theory in his 1959 book, The Clonal Selection Theory of Acquired Immunity. He was trained as MD. His important work on influenza and discovery of an influenza viral enzyme with the specificity for particular forms of neuraminic acid, which is still used today for detection. In 1960, he got Nobel Prize for the discovery of acquired immunological tolerance. Now, here we have Rodney Potter and Gerald M. Edelman. As we all know that in 1972, they got Nobel Prize for the discovery concerning the structure of antibodies. Many discoveries take place. We know the Rodney Potter was the first one who came up with the structure of the Y-shaped structure of antibody, the two arms, the light chain and the heavy chain. These are Baruch Pinasirov, George T. Schnell, John Doshet, who discovered genes that regulate immune responses, IR gene. Now, we call them as major histocompatibility antigen, MHC molecules. They got Nobel Prize in 1980. This is Niels Jerne and Milstein and Kohler. He got Nobel Prize in 1984 for theories concerning the specificity in development and control of immune system. The discovery of the principle for production of monoclonal antibody actually fetched all the three a Nobel Prize in 1984. Now, this is a list of Nobel laureates in immunology. As you can see, Emil von Behring got Nobel Prize in 1901 for his diphtheria antitoxin, Paul Ulrich in 1908 in adaptive immunity, autoimmunity, Eli Metchnikoff in phagocytosis, numerous Gerald Edelman for chemical structure of immunoglobulin. Of course, we still say that Potter was the one who came up with the structure of immunoglobulins, but it was actually Gerald Edelman as well as Rodney Potter who came up with the structure. Gerald Edelman was an American scientist, while Rodney Potter in UK actually came up with the structure of immunoglobulins. As already said, John Doshet, Schnell for MHC molecules, Niels Jerne and many other people for the theory of immunity, and later on the more common ones, Karl Landsteiner, who came up with the blood group antigens, of course Rosalind Fialo for RIA, that is radioimmunoassay, Joseph Murray in 1994 organ transplantation, Donald Thomas for bone marrow transplantation. This is this list is from the glittering prizes by Robert by Peter Doherty, which was given in Nature Immunology in 2010. Now lastly, I would like to say that scientist is definitely not a person who gives the right answers. He's the one who actually asks the right questions. So let's use our stories to encourage listening to one another and to hear not just the good news, but also the pain that lies at the back of a lot of people's stories and their histories. So thank you very much. Hope you learned many new things from learning about the history of immunology and how much hard work actually went, how much people were ridiculed and how much they had to face bad things from, they were subjected to so many bad mouths, they were mad mouthed by the community, by the neighborhood, that they were sometimes had to leave their native places. So despite of that, they came up with the discovery. So this is the scientific temperament which we all need to develop. Thank you very much.
Ma'am, I would like to ask you a few questions. I mean, can you just shed more light on techniques of vaccinations?
Well, actually, as I just told you, initially vaccination was variolation. There was two different techniques. One was variolation and one was vaccination. Variolation was just a physical technique where what they used to do, they used to take up the liquid material from the pustule of a person who is suffering from cowpox, would take it from there and then would put it into another person who is an elderly individual. This person has not been afflicted with disease, but by taking up the liquid material from the cowpox pustule through a needle and then just poking this needle, or sometimes what they used to do, they just took the swab from the cowpox pustule. You know, the swab is the dark thing which happens after a cowpox or smallpox, the thing which dries up crusts. They just used to take up that crust, put it, let the other person, a healthy individual, inhale that crust. So the viruses will go through the mucous membrane of the nostril, and then this healthy individual will develop some response, which is actually the antibody production, which is the primary response. This is what actually goes in vaccination also. From variolation, the process of vaccination came up. So today what we do in vaccination is, we just take a weakened pathogen, maybe anything, like even if I am talking about, let's say, smallpox, they will take a weakened pathogen, weakened by UV treatment, by heat treatment, by anything. They will take up the weakened pathogen and will inject it into your bloodstream. The body will, since it's a weakened pathogen, it will not develop into a full-fledged disease. The person will develop an antibody against this weakened pathogen. And now, once the actual pathogen comes, he already has a preformed antibody. So, he is protected. So, that is what vaccination takes care even now. So, we take a first dose of vaccine, and that dose is sufficient to produce a lot of antibodies in us, which is easy, which will be able to combat the disease when it actually strikes this organism.
Okay, ma'am, why was cowpox vaccine useful in case of smallpox?
See, cowpox and smallpox are very related viruses. So initially, they didn't know why it is taking place. As I just told you, that Edward Jenner just overheard a girl speaking to the physician that, since I have got cowpox, I am protected from smallpox, which was an observation. That is what I heard, this word serendipity. You know that he wasn't, it's just a good fortune, you know. But then a lot of thought came into his mind that probably this has some basis to it, you know. Truly, the cowpox and smallpox are actually very related viruses. One is vaccinia minor, the other is vaccinia major, very related one. The cowpox vaccine does not lead to a very bad disease. It's cowpox is a very it's not a bad disease. It is not a kind of a disease like smallpox was one of a terror, you know. Thousands of people used to die. There used to be epidemics of smallpox. So what they used to do, they used to take it from cowpox and use it in case of smallpox. Now being related, now we know that there are so many things. So viruses are related. The pathogen have relation. So if antibodies is produced against a cowpox virus, that same antibody is equally effective against smallpox. So this is what is actually happening, why cowpox is getting useful in smallpox, in combating smallpox. I hope I answered that question.
Yes, ma'am. On that note, I would like to thank you, ma'am, for this very enriching discussion. And I would like to thank you, dear friends, for watching our show. And I hope you have enjoyed and you have learned a lot about vaccination and immunology and its history. On that note, thank you, dear friends, for watching our show. Stay tuned and keep watching. Thank you.